let us rejoice and be glad in it. It is good to gather in God's house, giving praise and the honor and glory that is due unto his name. We're delighted that you've chosen to be here this morning, and we pray that indeed God will bless you in this time that we share together. We always want to welcome those that might be joining us by live stream, and indeed extend our best wishes to them and also blessings upon this day. As we look at the announcements, today is indeed the first day of Christmas time. I hope that you all had a wonderful Christmas celebration. Perhaps for some it was a tad bit different than others that we may have experienced in the past, with perhaps a few less family members and so forth, but God is in the midst of everything regardless of what our circumstances might be, and we thank him for it. And also we want to announce that for those who gave poinsettias, and the list is still available on the back pew if you are interested in that information. We appreciate the beauty that they add, especially at Christmas time, to our sanctuary. But if you would, after the service, pick those up, we would appreciate it. Also want to highlight one of the announcements that is on the sheet that you have before you. The Cryer Center has asked the community and churches to give clean, used coats to distribute to those that might be in need. And Faye has indicated that if you will bring them to the church, she would be glad to deliver them to the Cryer Center. But of course, you can take them there as well if you prefer. The Sunday school class meetings are listed in the bulletin. And as has been announced before, the Spirit of Love will consider their resuming class on Tuesdays in January. So we'll look ahead to that. Also want to remind you that if you have received Christmas cards, anybody received any Christmas cards? Are you all listening? I'm just checking. And if you receive Christmas cards, and I know that you all don't keep them all, I'm just going to be upfront about that. But if you would take the front covers, the front of the card, and without any personal notes written on the back of it, and bring them and put them in the box that is in front of my office, then I will send them off to St. Jude's Hospital. And they use them to make new cards, which they then sell to support their ministry. So just keep that in mind. It's not just Christmas cards, by the way. It's birthday cards. It's all occasion cards. It's cards, period. Okay? I know I emphasize it most often at Christmas, but it is any kind of card that you might have. It cannot have any writings on the back of it and a personal note, but I go through them anyway, so you don't have to worry about that. But you'd be interesting, the information I pick up from those calls. You might want to keep that in mind. I'm just kidding. All right. We will talk about more about this, but I'm sure that you have heard that there is going to be a funeral held here tomorrow morning for Norma Blake, and we want to be mindful of that as well. So are there any other announcements that need to be made? And please note our Lottie Moon offering. We have a goal of $500. We have received $695 to date. And so it would be wonderful to even increase that a bit. So if you've not given to that offering, I would encourage you to do so. Are there any other announcements? Let's prepare our hearts and minds to worship God. Thank you. The Word was made flesh, full of grace and truth. Christ lived among us. From Christ's fullness, we have received gift after gift of God's love. God is present. God is with us. Nothing can separate us from the love of God. Praise be to God, the Father, for the love that he has shown to us in his Son, Christ Jesus. Let us pray. Father, we come into your presence this morning, rejoicing, Father, in the season in which we celebrate. Rejoicing, Father, as we indeed remember once again with renewed commitment and energy the birth of your Son. Father, we recognize that this is indeed the greatest gift that has ever been given. It is the gift of salvation. It is the gift of eternal life. And so, Father, we come indeed to bring to you ourselves, all of us, to worship and praise your holy name, to rejoice in all that you are and all that you have revealed to us through Christ Jesus, in whose name we make our prayer. Amen. As we light all the candles, we include the white candle that symbolizes the long-expected visit of the Christ. We have often fallen short and walked in darkness, but we recognize in this great light the wonderful love of God. We proclaim and we celebrate the victory of the Prince of Peace.
John 1:1-5 says, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. Through him all things were made. Without him nothing was made that has been made. In him was life, and that life was the light of men. The light shines in the darkness, but the darkness has not understood it."
We have not reached the perfection we desire, yet the eloquence of the prophet and the humble joy of the shepherds affirm the birth of the Messiah transforms the world. How has this good news changed your life? How can you proclaim God's promise to those who need justice and assurance?
Pray with me. God of the past, the present and the future, we affirm our faith in your final triumph of your grace. Make us instruments of your reign, working for the transformation of this world. Amen.
Glory in the highest, and on the earth be peace.
His name is Jesus, for he takes away the sins of the world. As we come to our prayers of the people, we think indeed about all the acts of kindness, the ways that indeed the community reaches out and cares for one another. And I know that as you have watched the news broadcasts and other shows on television, you've seen that indeed, perhaps if anything has come out of this pandemic that is indeed we need to give God praise and honor and glory for, it is the kindness that we have seen others show to one another, that for those who are without work and in need of food and clothing and so forth, that people have reached out and indeed taken care of one another. We thank God for this. We thank God for all the blessings that we see. And we need to recognize, as I said before, that regardless of where we are in life, God is in the midst of it, because it's a promise that he gives to us. He promises us that he will never leave us. He will never forsake us. And I tell the kids, you know, there are not too many things that you can take to the bank, but that's one of them. You can bank on God's promises because he is faithful, and we thank him for it. As we look at our prayer list, I hope that you picked up the list that was on the back there for you to have. We do add to our list the family of Norma Blake that I've already mentioned, her funeral tomorrow, and then also the family of Walter Harrell. He died on Christmas Eve, and so we want to remember that family as well. We need indeed to continue to be in prayer for David. David is still in the hospital, and they are now dealing with his more recent diagnosis. And we know that the possibility, I think, is that he'll be there for perhaps as long as another month. So we certainly want to keep him in our prayers. I think he's maybe now receiving some text messages. Okay.
He was diagnosed with some type of leukemia, just I don't know what the name is. Good prognosis. They started his chemo yesterday. At that point, it didn't bother him. I don't know how these things go. But he complained a little bit to Ellie yesterday, which is a short time he's getting better. And the reason he will be there 4 more weeks is God works in mysterious ways. And unbeknown to him or any of us, David was waiting to write there. His heart was, he had a severe heart condition no one was aware of. And it all looks good. The doctor said yesterday, once we finish with the chemo, we're turning you over to the cardiac division. And he said, no, we'll get you straight. So God's good.
Mm-hmm. Yes, he is. Yeah. And indeed, he does work in mysterious ways. His wonders to behold, the scripture says. And so, you know, and it's good for us to affirm that and to know that indeed he is in the midst of our lives. Are there any others that might need to be added to our prayer list?
My daughter-in-law's mother, Candace's mother, has COVID. She has not been around anybody in the family, but she has a little 7-year-old son, JJ, who has asthma. So if we can just, you know, if he comes down with it, he might have complications.
And we are aware that this it continues to spread, even with the hopes of a vaccine is available, and I know they're getting those out and doing, you know, what they can. But we need to be very careful and also mindful of where we are in these days. If there are any decisions, of course, that we need to make concerning the church services, we will, of course, notify you of that. Let us pray together. Almighty and most merciful Father, we come to your throne of grace. Lord, you know that indeed in the midst of the holiday seasons, there are those who find themselves in difficult situations. some, Father, who are in the hospital. Lord, others who have faced the loss of a loved one. Father, those who, for reasons that perhaps even they themselves do not understand, fall into the grips of despair and sadness. And Father, we know that indeed on the night of the birth of your Son that the angels shouted glory to God in the highest. And so, Father, we do thank you for the beauty of the season. We thank you, Father, and we see with great joy the gift that you gave to us in Christ Jesus. But, Father, we pause this morning to acknowledge how many blessings. Father, to know and acknowledge that we are blessed with our homes. Father, with food and clothing. Lord, we are blessed with opportunities to share with one another. Father, we have before us now a ministry of providing coats for the needy, of giving of ourselves to those who are less fortunate than we. Father, we pray that indeed as you bless us, that we will indeed recognize that you use us as your instruments of grace here in our world and in our community. We thank you, Father, for the gifts that have been given through our honeymoon. But Father, what a great ministry this is, that money will go to missionaries around this globe, that others might hear the name of Jesus, that they will know his name, and they can proclaim the glory that is due unto him. So, Father, we ask that you would continue to bless our giving. Continue, Father, to bless us as we reach out to others. And, Lord, we thank you for our family and our friends. Lord, we praise you that we can indeed have those who walk beside us in difficult times. Those when we need encouragement and support are there to lift us up. Those when we are celebrating and joyful can join in the celebration. And Father, we thank you for our church family. We thank you for brothers and sisters in Christ. And Lord, although we acknowledge that none of us think alike, we all know your name. We know your name is Jesus. And we know, Father, that that is the center of our faith, that cross of Calvary. And we put our faith and our trust and our hopes totally in him. And we come together, Father, to support and encourage one another as we walk each on our journey of faith. And Father, we do pause. We pause to lift up to your throne of grace those that are on our prayer list. Lord, you know the needs of each and every family and person more acutely than we do. You know, Father, the desires of their hearts, things that perhaps they have not even been willing to voice. Lord, you know the prayers of people that are never spoken, those unspoken prayers that rise up to your throne of grace, Father. We pray that indeed you would be a blessing to them. Father, give each person in need a sense of your presence at this time. Allow them, Lord, to know that they are being lifted up to your throne by the community of faith. Wrap your arms around them, Father, and give them that great assurance that you are indeed always with them, that you never leave them, you never forsake them. And Father, as we celebrate this day, we do indeed celebrate the gift. The gift that you gave to us in Christ Jesus, our Lord, our Savior, our friend, in whose name we pray. Indeed, the ministrants and ministries of Harmony Grove Baptist Church are indeed based upon your generous contributions of your tithes and offerings, for which we do indeed thank you. And so we give God praise for the gifts that you bring, for the offerings that you have indeed contributed to the ongoing work of our church. And Betty Kay is going to have an offertory prayer.
Let us pray. Most gracious Heavenly Father, Lord, we come to you with humble supplication as we come before you, thanking you and praising you for the many, many blessings that you give us each and every day. Lord, be with those that have had surgery, that have had tests, that are in the hospital, that are in our nursing homes. Be with them and guide them and help them in this time of extreme danger outside to them as well. And Lord, we come now to bring our tithes and offerings back to you so that you can take these and use them so that we can further your kingdom here on earth. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
I have no peace to bring, power up. The gospel.
This is indeed what we celebrate, not only during this season, but in all of the seasons throughout the year. We celebrate the gift of Jesus Christ. The words of the story are so very familiar to us. As you probably have recognized that I read from a translation other than the King James, and that's hard for me to do. It's hard indeed to get the words even to come off of the pages when it's not King James, because we memorized it. I know most of you did at some point in time in your life. But these words are familiar, and we perhaps risk losing that awe and that wonder that was experienced on that holy night. You know, it's not unusual for a birth of a child. Isn't it interesting and fascinating that God doesn't choose the big bang moments that we would perhaps expect? He certainly didn't choose the way the children of Israel thought this would all come about. He did it in the most normal kind of way, except for the conception, in the birth of a child. I remember one year I was talking with children, doing a children's message. And so I asked them to share with me their birth story. Now, you all have a birth story that your parents told you? Anybody?
Yeah.
Anybody else? Okay. You know, I have always shared with my children their birth stories. I'm not sharing them with you, by the way. Although there's nothing wrong with them, if we just don't have time. But these kids all looked at me like you all did. What in the world is she talking about? A birth story? So, you're left with no participation, so you have to improvise, right? You've got to be good to get this done. So I had to come up quickly with a birth story that I could share with them and tell them about in order to then lead into the fact that there's a birth story in the scriptures about Jesus. A birth story, indeed, here in the ancient world, a birth story about a son. And you know how I feel about this. A son. Now, in the ancient world, when a son was born, there was great celebration. Well, we know the story about Jesus' birth. He was born in a stable. He was in a manger, a trough for his cradle. But the celebration, the celebration was unique within itself. There was great excitement. There was a little bit of ceremony. You know, in our time, when there is a child born, you send out birth announcements, right? You send it out. Maybe now you do it online and email and all that. Maybe even do Zoom. Who knows? But you send out an announcement because that's exciting. And you list on that announcement the name that you've given to the child, and you tell them exactly what time they were born. You indicate how much they weighed, how long they were, who the proud parents are, and if there were any siblings, you know, they rejoiced in all of this as well. Christ didn't have any of that exactly. But what did he have? He had a pretty good announcement, didn't he? For we find indeed that announcement was sent out. And it was sent out by the Father, the Heavenly Father. It was sent out by God himself. It was sent out by God's messengers. It was sent out by an angel. And yet God still doesn't do the expected. Because he didn't send this announcement out to the religious leaders. He didn't tell the priests and the scribes, the Pharisees, the Sadducees. He didn't tell Caesar Augusta. He didn't tell Herod. He told shepherds. Shepherds abiding in the fields. Those people who were lowest on the totem pole of society. You know what I'm talking about. Those who were marginalized. Shepherds were basically despised. They were looked down upon, and they were despised because they couldn't maintain the rituals, the rules that had been established by the priests for that everyday people just couldn't do. They were unable to keep the ceremonial laws. They couldn't observe all that hand washing, something that we've probably gotten real familiar with these days, right? Washing the hands all the time. They were big on that, even back in those ancient days. Shepherds out in the field, not so likely, right? They couldn't observe what had been established for them to be considered proper, upright, outstanding Jewish people. And so indeed they were lowly, despised, they were poor, but it was to them that God sent his angel to announce the birth. And there was, in all likelihood, the very special shepherds, because they had a very special task. As you have already figured out from knowing the scriptures so very well, they were out in fields outside of Bethlehem. You know that, right? Well, if you did, it's a fact, okay? And Bethlehem is about 6 miles from Jerusalem. And Jerusalem is the center of the faith of the Israelites. Their temple is there. Everyone who is a good Jew, whenever they had opportunity, would go to Jerusalem, to that temple. And as you well know, every morning and every evening in the temple, there was a sacrifice. A sacrifice for the forgiveness of the sins of the people. And that sacrifice had to be an unblemished lamb. An unblemished lamb. And during the season of Passover, which we celebrate Easter about that time, their annual celebration, they would indeed celebrate having been brought out of Egypt, out of captivity. And every family would have to sacrifice a lamb, an unblemished, pure lamb. And they estimate that that would be about 250,000 lambs that would be sacrificed during Passover. So you've got the sacrifice every morning and evening, and you then have this particular celebration. So there are lots of lambs that have to be perfect, have to be unblemished. And so indeed, the temple authorities had their own flocks, because they're going to make quite a bit of money, by the way, selling these lambs to the people. And so, out in those pastures, these shepherds were tending those flocks, most likely. They tell us that the tower of flock was for watching for the sheep, because you know, any good shepherd, like any good farmer today, if you have cattle or sheep or so forth, you know when there's a pregnant lamb among them, and they know to watch for it to be born, right? And so they had a watchtower, and they would watch the flocks from above, and they would watch those that they knew were soon to give birth, because when the sheep were born, the shepherds went out and got the baby lamb, and they wrapped them in cloth. They wrapped the sheep in swaddling clothes, and they laid them in a trough, a manger, until they could inspect that little lamb to make sure that it had no blemishes. And then they would watch it. They would be willing to give their lives to protect these sheep. They would keep them from falling over the rugged ravines and cliffs. They protected them, of course, from wild animals. They would do whatever it took to protect these sheep and lambs. And so sheep herding was hereditary. It went on from generation to generation to generation. It's sort of like having a family business and just keep passing it on, right? And so they knew how to do this. They knew what it was to protect these lambs and to care for them. And so indeed, they needed to have these perfect lambs. And they have to be the firstborn. Is this beginning to sound any kind of familiar to a child we celebrate? Firstborn, without blemish, taken to Jerusalem to be sacrificed before the Lord to atone for sin. It was to such shepherds as this that night to whom the angel appeared to announce what would be the first newborn son of Mary and of God. A newborn king wrapped in swaddling clothes. Now, can you envision what went through the minds of these shepherds when they heard the news? See, we hear it and it doesn't have any more of the meaning than we've heard it over and over and over again. But you know, my friends, when those shepherds heard it, they heard the angel saying, "Born to you this day in the city of David." They know all about the city of David. They're Jewish. "Born this day in the city of David, there is a Savior, the Christ, the Messiah, the King, and he's wrapped in swaddling clothes." Firstborn, swaddling clothes, and he's lying in a stall, a manger. Oh, my friends, those shepherds immediately knew. They had received good news from God himself, but they had received news that they understood, probably, as I said, in a way that none of us would have ever grasped. Because in what the angel said to them that night, they knew that Jesus was indeed the perfect Lamb of God, and that he would be sacrificed. They got it. And then, of course, we know that with that angel, there appeared the great heavenly host, singing praises to God. Glory to God in the highest, and on peace, goodwill among men. And then it's all quiet. And the shepherds look at one another and said, we've got to go check this out. We've got to see this thing that has been made known unto us. And so they tell us that indeed they went into Bethlehem. They went into Bethlehem because they knew that they were going to worship a king, this little bitty innocent baby. They knew. And the scriptures tell us that they shared this message with whomever was there, Mary and Joseph. We don't know if there was anyone else there. And they were astonished. Because the shepherds had a depth of understanding of exactly what would be. They knew that this was indeed the Savior, the Christ, the Messiah, the child that would be set apart to die. The child who would be the perfect Lamb of God, who would atone for the sins of the world, the one who would atone for our sins, so that we could be restored into a new and right relationship with God the Father through Him. The story of the birth of Christ speaks to the unexpected ways that God works in the midst of our world. You know, as Pumpkin said earlier, God works in mysterious ways, His wonders to behold. And that is absolutely true. He works in unexpected ways, things that we could never think or imagine, in order to carry out His purpose and His plan for each and every one of us as we travel through this life. You know, during the stay that Mary and Joseph had in Bethlehem, Jesus was born, not in a palace. You know, the Israelites expected God to send a great warrior, not a baby. They expected a great king, but not one who would be sacrificed. They had great expectations of what God was going to do in their behalf. But God's playbook was quite different from theirs. And so I think, my friends, that from the story, we can indeed recognize the fact that God stepped into this life and into this world, became flesh, as the word says, and dwelt among us in a simple, bare-boned way. He was born to a poor but righteous and holy family. The stable had none of the pomp and circumstances that you would expect for the glory of God to flood into, but it is His glory that floods into that stable that night. The story of Jesus reminds all that God is with. He's with the poor. He's with the disenfranchised. He's with the marginalized. He is with all, regardless of circumstances. It is a reminder that God's grace of Christ is indeed for the world, a gift for any who are willing to receive it. You know, 3 decades later, when John the Baptist stood onto the scene, indeed as a forerunner of Jesus Christ, to proclaim what He would be about and who He was, in the Gospel of John, as John the Baptist looked one day and saw Jesus coming. He said to his own followers, "Behold, the Lamb of God. Behold, the Lamb of God that takes away the sins of the world." And you know, my friends, more than 2,000 years later, Jesus Christ, the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, the Messiah, he is still taking away the sins of all of those who are willing to accept him. He was indeed the perfect sacrifice made on our behalf. That little child wrapped in swaddling clothes and lying in a manger was the Christ. His name is Jesus. For he takes away the sins of the people. He indeed presents us to the throne of God so that we too, because of him, are washed clean and pure and perfect. His sacrifice renewed the peace between us and God himself. And so, my friends, as we celebrate in this holy time, as we have just celebrated his birth 2 days ago, we need to say thanks be to God for that indescribable, inexpressible gift that he gave to us, the gift of Christ Jesus, our Lord and Savior. Praise be to God. Amen. Forth and forevermore. Amen. May you go in peace. God bless you.